as we get really proficient at a video game. Our brain changes while we're playing it. It's not the same when you first learn the game and when you're an expert and you play. The brain activity isn't the same. In fact, there's even less brain activity once you're an expert. You kind of make everything automatized and easier. So we're studying how that process unfolds in the brain. But then even more interesting, I think, we're studying how your brain activity when you first come into the lab, when you haven't played the game at all, how much that can predict your future improvement in the game and your future improvement in other things, like whether your memory improves or whether your reaction time improves outside of the game. So the game is a really boring old game that was invented here at the University of Illinois in the 1980s to study some basic cognitive tasks like memory and reaction time. So you have to fly around this space environment, and if you've ever played those games, you know it's hard and your plane goes flying around. So lots of the early learning is subjects learning to control this ship in space. But then at the same time, we have some other tasks that are embedded in the game. So there's these complex processes that are kind of built on top of this basic flying game. They play the game for their first couple times with EEG on, with a full head of EEG on. We can control each individual aspect, and we know the exact milliseconds where things come on the screen, which allows us to time lock our EEG data so we can find exactly which type of brain waves or brain activity were happening. So we get their brain activity when they're first learning to play the game, and then they play the game for 20 hours over the next month. And then we bring them back and we compare how much they improved during that training again, and then go back to the first set of brain activity and try to make some predictions. What we found that was really interesting was that people that learned to play the game the fastest, they had the most alpha oscillations, alpha waves, when they first played the game. And alpha waves are a particular type of brain activity where big groups of your neurons all fire together in synchrony 10 times every second. The people that improved had more power alpha waves, so it wasn't that they were happening faster, it's that they had bigger groups of neurons, they were all firing together and coming off together. So their brainwave was more coordinated in its alpha. Even not when they're playing, but we bring them in the lab and have them do some other tasks on the side that aren't even the game, and we can use their alpha waves from that side task before they've even played the game at all to predict how fast they'll learn this game. The first EEG finding in the 1930s was that Hans Berger put EEG on his son and found that when his son closed his eyes or stopped paying attention, that this alpha activity would go up. There'd be more peaks 10 times every second. And so that was thought of as just kind of the idling process of the brain. But it's come to be found in many more brain areas that this is a more controlled kind of inhibition. So it's not just an off that just happens whenever you're not doing anything, but you can selectively choose which parts of your brain to inhibit with these alpha oscillations. We didn't try to predict who would be the best when they're done playing. We weren't able to predict that as well. What we are able to predict is the kind of the slope that people learn. So we don't know where people are going to end up after a certain time, but we just know the trajectory that they're going to take to get there, which is perhaps more interesting because the endpoint is probably just a function of different people's learning slopes, but the real difference is like, can you learn it in a second, or does it take you a little longer? And that's what educators and trainers and military would want to know more about, is kind of which are the people that can get it in a second and which are the people that you need to drive the training a little bit more. Another interesting thing is that it's become clear you can kind of give people feedback in real time about their alpha, which is something we haven't done here, but we want to try. So you can measure their alpha and then tell them how much they have and say, okay, increase it. And they don't necessarily know how to increase it, but they'll try something, and if it works, you'll give them feedback, and slowly you can get them to boost up or dampen their alpha. And we might try to do this when people first start playing a game and see if we can manipulate their future learning, which would be really cool if we can really like change people's propensity to play a game just by boosting how they go into it that first time. That would be really amazing.